as we navigate uncharted territory with COVID-19. There's a lot of talk about a possible vaccine, when it would be available, and how it offers hope as medical professionals treat this new virus. Carolee McGrath sat down with Dr. Peter Friedman, the Chief Research Officer of Bay State Health, to learn more about a potential vaccine, the time it takes to develop it, and how vaccines have changed and saved lives.
If you listen to Dr. Fauci, the best estimate is it will take about a year to a year and a half. Based on how quickly things are moving, I think it's going to probably be closer to a year.
And what typically is that time frame? Because people are like, wow, a year and a half, that seems so far out. Talk a little bit about the process of creating a vaccine.
Yeah, it's a very complex process to create a vaccine. First, you have to identify the protein on the pathogen, in this case, a virus, that you want your body to create antibodies to. And you need to identify a protein that is not similar to a human protein, because then you would create an autoimmune situation if you vaccinated people. So you need something that's different enough. Fortunately, in the case of what's now called SARS-CoV-2, which is this virus, it is an RNA virus, which is different in many respects from human cells. So you'll be able to find proteins. And one of the things that we learned from the SARS epidemic, which is a cousin of the current virus, is there are these little spikes that come out. If you've seen pictures of it, that's why they call it coronavirus. Corona means crown. It's sort of like the points on the top of a crown. They call those the spike proteins. And those proteins we did find during the development of the vaccine for SARS that those do create immune response. And so the current vaccine that's being tested, it's actually coming out of a company in Norwood, Mass, called Moderna, working with NIH, does target those spike proteins. But even so, you have to establish that the vaccine is safe. And it has to be extraordinarily safe. I mean, you think about it, let's say it had bad effects in like 0.1% of people, a very small number of people. If you're going to give a vaccine to hundreds of millions of people, or even in this case, maybe billions of people, even if it has that small a risk of adverse effects, we're talking about, you know, hundreds of thousands of people who would experience bad effects. So you really want something that's extremely safe. And that's what they're establishing now. They're actually starting for the Moderna vaccine. The phase one studies are starting in Seattle. They're going to start with, I think, 45 patients. At least this is what I've heard. And they will give them the prototype vaccine to see if it's safe, if anybody gets bad effects, and if they develop antibodies to it. After that, then it's a question of larger scale human testing to see that a lot of folks develop immune response and that it's, again, that it's not producing a lot of adverse effects. That can take months to do a trial like that. And then you have to produce the vaccine in quantities. I mean, so they produce a small amount for the purposes of these trials, but you have to be able to produce enough to be able to do widespread vaccination. It used to be a lot of it had to be sort of grown in culture, and that took a very long time to do. This particular vaccine, because it's using recombinant technology, may be able to be produced more quickly. And that's why they're thinking within a year. And then there's distribution and all these other things that go into getting it out to the people who need it. So that's sort of where you get the idea of this taking a year. And let me just say, if it happens in a year, that will be a world record. I mean, it typically takes many years for a vaccine to make it to market.
Now, there was some discussion. I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, I'm saying, and even then, we don't know if it's going to be effective long term. I mean, one of the things we see with influenza vaccine, the flu vaccine, is every year, right? You have to get your flu shot different because different proteins that are present, the virus mutates, it changes from year to year. Some of that is it changing its genetics, but some of it is also natural selection, right? We create vaccines that have antibodies that kill off certain of the influenza viruses, but then the ones that survive, those are the ones that propagate. So there's a lot that goes into it, and that's sort of what makes it so challenging.
You were talking about the effectiveness of the flu vaccine. How effective do you think this vaccine will be when it is widely distributed?
Well, that's what we don't know. That's, I think, the, several billion dollar question. Certainly a huge question for this company in here in Massachusetts, and would be a huge boon to our biotech industry. And of course, a huge boon to our patients and healthcare workers. I think healthcare workers probably would be the first folks who would be vaccinated if we had a vaccine. You know, it's challenging because coronavirus is known to mutate quite readily. For example, a lot of the common cold viruses are related to that. And as you know, we don't get a yearly shot for to prevent the common cold because it's so challenging to figure out what the right proteins are because it transforms so quickly. So, many of us are hopeful, but I certainly don't think we're there yet, and it would be pure speculation to really give you a clear answer to the question you posed.
Some people have talked a little bit about possibly fast-tracking the vaccine in terms of those healthcare workers that you had mentioned, perhaps making it available to them first, which I know would be an FDA sort of decision. Is that something that you foresee happening?
I don't. We don't know enough about its safety, and you wouldn't want to risk, particularly in the midst of a pandemic, you wouldn't want to risk the health of your workforce. And we also don't know how effective it is. So part of the concern would be if people got the vaccine, maybe they would be less stringent about using personal protective equipment, maybe take some, stop taking some of the precautions. And since we don't know how effective the vaccine is, that could really have harmful consequences. So I don't see that happening. These are unprecedented times. You just don't know.
When you look at the history of vaccines in the country, and I looked back at, polio, for example, and just how it just was, a game changer in those times. How important is it for people to understand the work that goes into these vaccines and what they really mean to public health?
Yeah, vaccination is one of the tremendous successes of 20th century public health. He'd say 19th and 20th century public health. When you think of diseases like smallpox that or polio that we now don't really worry about, but in the 50s, people worried about polio. 40s and 50s was a huge problem. Smallpox, was a major killer worldwide for centuries. And now it really only exists in a laboratory, a couple laboratories around the world. So it has really been a tremendous, tremendous success in the realm of public health and medicine. And I hope that technology will work for this virus. It hasn't worked as well for some conditions. We still don't have, for example, a vaccine for malaria, which is a huge cause of morbidity and mortality worldwide, as an example. I'm cautiously optimistic and hopeful, but I think we still have to keep doing the things that we're doing And I want to emphasize to your audience, you know, the importance of sort of traditional epidemiologic approaches to pandemics like this. So very careful hand washing and social distancing really, really is important.